following program is classified G. It's suitable for all ages.
Tonight, we look into the freedom of expression of people on social media. The pandemic period has proven the importance of having accurate and reliable information being spread amongst the general public. The country has taken a stronger approach in this light, especially in the past few months. This was primarily due to multiple situations arising where state officials had to rebuke myths spreading on social media. On the 7th of June, the Criminal Investigations Department put together a special team of officers to take action against the propagation of false news on social media platforms. Recently, a teenager from the Gampala region was arrested following a tip received to the police with regards to fake news circulating. Legal questions have arisen by activists and social media groups as to which extent the freedom of expression can be exercised. Welcome to Law, Land and Liberty, where we discuss the contemporary matters pertaining to the legal landscape within Sri Lanka. This week, today actually, we are going to discuss what is happening with the social media and the legal aspects that is pertaining to it. We have a very special guest with us who's going to give us the context to this, the legal outlining of what exactly is happening within the country. So we have Senior DIG Ajit Rohan with us. Sir, when you joined us before on Gen XYZ, I had to introduce you as DIG, but today it's Senior DIG Ajit Rohan. Thank you, sir, so much for spending time with us. Before we go into the first segment, we will be looking at today's topic in four specific areas. That is, firstly, the freedom of expression, secondly, the laws pertaining to misinformation, then on defamation law, and finally, on the responsibilities of the public.
Hello, I'm Vishmita Pereira. I'm a training pilot. Today, my question is about freedom of expression. How does the law in Sri Lanka protect freedom of expression, especially within social media?
Sir, if we get right into the topic, and our first segment will be on the freedom of expression, and our first question will be on how the Sri Lankan law in particular protects the freedom of expression, especially within the social media. Now, the reason why we bring these topics up is I think you have taken a frontline task in this as well, because when it comes to first these days, the pandemic, before we had the Easter Sunday attacks and we had a lot of other situations where people or individuals spread information that may have been detrimental in certain scenarios. So in that context, how does the Sri Lankan law protect the freedom of expression?
Well, first of all, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to Derana 24/7 channel for the invitation. And I think after I was promoted to the rank of Senior DIG, so this is the first program that I am attending, and especially on an English channel. Discuss the Sri Lankan context, so I would like to mention about the international legal provisions of freedom of expression, how this particular concept came to our legal system. As you all know, on the 10th of December 1948, United Nations organization introduces very special document to the world. So that is called UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. First time in the history, so before that there were several ad hoc documents, but so this is the first instrument or the document which carried provisions in respect of freedom of expression. Then thereafter, this document became a legal document, actually the legally bound document in 1966. So that particular document is called ICCPR, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. according to the provisions of ICCPR, one of the key features of that particular document is the concept of freedom of expression. As we all know, if we have ratified an international convention, so what is the next step? Now, the United Nations Organization or the World Health Organization, ILO, Labour Organization, so many international organizations, they introduce, they present various documents. So there are two types of documents. One is called declarations. So the other ones are called conventions. Mm-hmm. So if we have ratified a convention,
you have to enact,
then we need to make domestic laws.
Yeah.
To give an effect to that particular document. So accordingly, being a member of the United Nations organization, Sri Lanka ratified the ICCPR, and first time in the history, the provisions of ICCPR was embodied in 1972 Constitution. The first Republic Constitution. So we deviated from the British Crown and we created our own constitution in 1972. Then thereafter again, in 1978, the Second Republic Constitution was introduced by the government with two-third majority, and the Chapter 3 of the 1978 Constitution carried a special chapter called Fundamental Rights Chapter. Fundamental Rights. So the fundamental rights, all the rights that have been embodied in the Chapter 3 of the Constitution have been extracted from
ICCPR.
So there are many rights. Mm-hmm. One of them is freedom of expression.
Yeah.
Freedom of expression. So I would like to mention the rights that are embodied in our constitution in Article 14.1.
Mm-hmm. That is where it's mentioned in pertaining to the freedom of expression.
Yeah. Article 14.1 states, every citizen is entitled to the freedom of speech and expression, including publication. So the word citizen, it should be emphasized. So there are fundamental rights that are embodied in Chapter 3. So some fundamental rights, such as freedom of thought, religion, conscience. So those articles say every person. But here, what the article mentions, every citizen of this country is entitled freedom of expression. So this particular concept was elaborated with the 19th Amendment of the Constitution. Apart from freedom of expression concept, the 19th Amendment introduced another concept called right to information. Mm-hmm. Right to information. That particular concept has been embodied in the Article 14A of the Constitution. So we have freedom of expression, printing something, expressing something, speaking, mm-hmm. and apart from that, on the other hand, the citizens have a right to obtain information from government institutions.
Okay. I think that really puts into perspective exactly what freedom of expression is and the provisions within the constitution. There are a few other segments that we need to go into before which we'll take a very short break, sir. We are in conversation with the senior DIG, Ajit Rohana. He's the police spokesperson, he's also a lawyer. He has joined us again to bring in something pertinent to our country as of now. With Law, Land and Liberty, stay with us.
Virakkodi, and I'm a medical student. My question is about laws on misinformation and what provisions are present within the law to combat misinformation.
Welcome back to Law, Land and Liberty. We are in conversation with Senior DIG Ajit Rohana. Sir, once again, thank you for joining us during this time period to discuss this matter. Now, something more pertinent to current status quo, that is misinformation and laws against misinformation. So the question I have for you categorically, like directly, what I have to ask you is what provisions are present within the law as per combating misinformation? How can it be combated? What sort of steps will be taken from the side of the law? Now, this has been a unique point that I think you personally was also criticized as per how it's going to be enacted. There is a big debate as to what qualifies for misinformation and what provisions are present either in the Penal Code, and I believe the Computer Crimes Act is also involved here. If you could clarify some of these stances, I think it'll be very important. I'm going to follow that up with the laws that pertain to the media as well. I need to ask you, you know, whether the media gets a ticket away from this. But firstly, if you can just explain to us a bit about misinformation and how the police who are enacting the law will be looking at it.
Yes, sure. Well, I explained about the constitutional provisions of freedom of expression.
Exactly.
But let me explain the limitations. Mm-hmm. The freedom of expression is not an absolute right. Now, there are rights that are embodied in the constitution, so no one can make any limitation. For instance, torture. So if it is a torture, so there are no restrictions at all. I mean, I cannot conduct the activities of torture under any circumstances. It is strictly prohibited. It's a universal right. For instance, the freedom of thought or religion. So no one can restrict. But whereas the freedom of expression is concern, so there are limitations. Mm. So the limitations are embodied in the section Article 15.2 of the Constitution. So I would like to read out Article 15.2.
Yes.
The exercise and operation of the fundamental rights declared and recognized by Article 14.1A, freedom of expression is one of the rights.
Yeah.
Shall be subjected to such restrictions as may be prescribed by the law in the interest of racial religious harmony.
Mm-hmm.
So if somebody is creating nudes to create religious or racial disharmony, so
that will be held account.
Yes. So he cannot do it. It's not an absolute right. And apart from that, in relation to parliamentary privilege, contempt of court, defamation, or incitement and offense.
Yeah.
Defamation.
Defamation we'll take separately,
yeah.
So I want to discuss it in detail.
Yeah. Now, if somebody is trying to, slinging mud at another person.
I want to take that separately.
So, okay. So it is not permitted. It is not permitted. And apart from that, Subarticle 7 of the Article 15 of the Constitution, it says, the exercise an operation of all the fundamental rights declared and recognized by Article 12, 13, 1, 13, 2, and 14. 14 means the freedom of expression concept is in the Article 14, shall be subjected to such restrictions as may be prescribed by the law in the interest of national security. If somebody is expressing something and it is against the national security, so he cannot do it. Or public order. If that particular person is creating public annoyance or creating conflict between ethnic groups, so it is not permitted. And the protection of public health. Mm-hmm. Protection of public health. Now,
if I'm not mistaken, this is also mentioned in the Computer Crime Act as well.
Yes, there are three, but here there are seven. Okay. Now you see,
if you can just touch on the sentencing also that happens.
Yes, sure. Now, this is an article. This is an article that was circulated 8 months ago on internet, Facebook. This is about a private hospital situated in Colombo. Mm.
Yeah, okay.
According to this article, this news, so it was said that a pregnant mother tested positive corona, and the baby, the newly born baby, has been identified as a COVID patient. So what happened? What happened? So all the mothers who were scheduled to admit to that particular hospital, so they didn't come. So the mothers already made deliveries. So they were crying because in the labor room sometimes it might be transmitted or the babies were together. So a panic was created. But absolutely it was a fake and bogus news. So what happened? It's against the health. Against the health. And so apart from that,
were you able to take action against this?
Yes, I'm going to elaborate. Yeah. And morality. Mm-hmm. Morality. So if somebody is trying to circulate, so freedom of expression is there. You know, some phonographic photographs, so other things, so that is against the morality. And others' rights. Others' rights. So now we are fighting for our rights, but we cannot violate others' rights. So therefore, so those are the limitations. So then we have informed our police officers, we have informed our investigation units to respect the rights of the freedom of expression, especially the news that are being circulated in social media, WhatsApp groups, Facebook. But on the other hand, if a person is violating the constitution willfully, we need to take action, because police is the one and only organization that has been empowered by the law to conduct investigation, to preserve peace and public order, and to preserve the rights of the citizen of this country. Not only the citizen, but also others, even foreigners. So therefore, we are compelled to take action. Now I'm going to explain the offenses.
Yeah.
Offenses in respect of this type of news. We have offenses that are embodied in the ICCPR Act,
exactly.
Sri Lanka Penal Code, then Prevention of Terrorism Act, and various statutes. Now,
in between this, I would like if you could mention the penalties
that
applied also.
Sure.
You mentioned, yeah.
Sure. Now, this particular news circulated at the latter part of the first wave. we were thinking of exit strategy in the first week of June 2020 because no COVID positive patient was found. However, on the 8th of June, this was circulated. Polgahavela, other Polgahavela Rohalenut, Asaditi in the Deniku Hamuela. Two COVID positive patients
from
found in Polgahavela Hospital. So what happened?
Not a government announcement.
No, it was not a government announcement, but not a fake news. It's not a real news. It was a fake news. Then, so everyone was talking. So why the government was going to open up the country? Again, two patients have been found Polgahavela. Then thereafter, that hospital people also, they were in a panicky situation. But we conducted investigation. So the news was fake and we arrested that particular person.
So there's a lot more I need to let you continue, but we have to take a very short break. If you can, within our next segment, we are going to touch on defamation, and I want to get your take on the penalties when it comes to both defamation and for misinformation.
Yeah.
Before we go in for a break, we are going to go into our special segment where Anuradha Vikramasinghe, our very own Anuradha Vikramasinghe, will bring to you Law in the Land with the news that is happening these days within the legal system, within the legal atmosphere within this country. Anuradha.
Thank you, Ganilu. This has been an eventful week in the legal field. Let's take a look as to how the law has worked in our land. Judge AHMD Nawaz recused himself from hearing the fundamental rights petitions filed by MP Richard Baduuddin and his brother Riyaj Baduuddin, challenging their arrest and detention over the 2019 Easter Sunday terror attacks. This is the third judge to recuse himself from this hearing. Previously, Supreme Court judges Janak De Silva and Yasantha Kodagode recused themselves from the hearing citing personal reasons. The Cabinet of Ministers has approved the establishment of a small claims court with a jurisdiction to hear cases below a specific monetary threshold. Justice Minister Ali Sabri's coordinating secretary, Attorney at Law Shamir Zawahir, stated its goal is to ease the caseload of the district court, which would then be able to hear disputes of a higher value more efficiently, and also to introduce a faster, more efficient procedure for the recovery of small claims. Three police officers of the Police Narcotics Division who were under detention orders for over 1 year after being arrested in connection with a drug racket have been remanded until the 28th of June by the Colombo Magistrates Court. The sub-inspector, sergeant and constable who were produced before the Colombo Chief Magistrate Buddhigasi Ragala by the Criminal Investigations Department. CID officers informed the court that investigations into the suspect have not been concluded and therefore requested they be placed under remand custody. Following an extensive long-running investigation carried out by Panadurawalana Anti-Corruption Unit, several individuals were arrested in connection with a narcotics network. Interrogations into the arrested duo have led to the arrest of five other suspects engaged in drug dealing in the southern province. A 42-year-old man was taken into custody along with 190 grams of heroin, along with a 27-year-old youth at Mathura Fort, while in possession of 160 grams of heroin. Further, three others were apprehended in the Valigama area along with 650 grams of heroin. Reportedly, the said racket was operated by ill-famed criminal gang member and drug trafficker Nadun Chintaka, who is currently hiding in Dubai, UAE. He is wanted by the local law enforcement authorities over several criminal activities. A government analyst has stated that the assistance of the parent company that manufactured the voyage data recorder of the fire-stricken cargo ship Express Pearl needs to be sought in order to further analyze its data. Police spokesman Senior DIG Ajit Rohana had stated that relevant coordination work is now underway to consult the company in question. The brother-in-law of organized crime gang leader Angad Alokka, who died in India some time back, has been arrested on charges of selling heroin. The suspect was arrested by the Nugegoda Divisional Narcotics Unit in the Mullerryav area. Police have also arrested a manager of a leading finance company in Sri Lanka who was with the suspect. 10 grams of heroin, rupees 2.5 million in cash and gold, rupees 1.5 million, has also been found in the possession of the suspects. That was a look at the major events of how the law has worked in our land. We'll now go in for a short commercial break. Danidhi Vithanavasam will be back after the break on Law, Land and Liberty.
name is Shanand Silva. I study hospitality management. And my question is about defamation. How is defamation in social media addressed in Sri Lankan law?
Welcome back to Law, Land and Liberty. We are in conversation with Senior DIG Ajith Rohana. Sir, I believe I had to cut you short in this previous segment while you were explaining on misinformation, and that is in fact a big segment. Mm. If you can, now we need to move into defamation.
Yeah.
And my question will be directly on how is defamation within social media being addressed within the country. And this comes from now people being defamed, either business individuals or, you know, particular individuals. And sometimes they have no methods of taking action because there is anonymous sources and all of that. So it's a little confusing. If you can just finish off your thoughts on misinformation as well and just touch on this aspect and tell us how we can get justice in the law.
Yeah. So give me, some minutes in order to explain the existing legal provisions in respect of fake news or the bogus news and impersonation cases. Now, according to our law, we enacted a special law in 2007. So that is called Act Number 56 of 2007, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights Act. So according to that act, Section 3 of the act, it says, no person shall propagate war or advocate national, racial or religious hatred that constitutes incitement or discrimination, hostility or violence. So it is an offense. So if a person has committed, as you all know, the Saharan group, so during that time in year, according to our investigation, it has been revealed that they had used social media, WhatsApp groups to cultivate the ideology of extremism among the innocent children of Kalmuna, Samantura, Akkarpattu, that areas. So that particular person, now Saharan is no more, now he committed suicide, but his followers are there. In the recent past, we arrested three of them, and they have committed this offense because it's a religious hatred situation they have created. So according to the act, the punishment, you cannot get bail from the magistrate court. The bail application should be filed in high court. So, and apart from that, the punishment is
up to 5 years, is it?
10 years rigorous imprisonment. 10 years rigorous imprisonment. And apart from that, according to the provisions of Sri Lanka Penal Code, Section 20 of 120 of the Sri Lankan Penal Code, it is an offence, and 3 years rigorous imprisonment could be imposed on this type of offences. By provoking the ideology of racial, ethnic disharmony. Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, if you are spreading fake or false news to create a panic among the inhabitants of the country, it is an offence under the Section 98 of the Police Ordinance. Mm-hmm. Section 98 of the Police Ordinance. So, apart from that, if you are leaking information, if you are making false news against the national security, territorial integrity or the sovereignty of the country, so it is also an offence under the Prevention of Terrorism Act, Act Number 48 of 1979. So there are many offences embodied in our statutes. So the offences are dealt with various institutions, and apart from that, the Penal Code, Section 292. Those sections are dealt with the religious disharmony. If you are creating fake news in order to create clashes between various religious groups, it is also an offense. Okay. So the offenders could be arrested without a warrant. by a police officer or by a peace officer, and we are taking actions. So why we are taking action? So now everyone is talking
We'll talk about that responsibility aspect in the last segment. If you can touch on defamation there itself, and we'll talk again about what we as the public should be doing within our last segment. We'll take some time on it. If you can touch on defamation, sir, I think a lot of people would like to know, because that's a practical problem that a lot of people are facing.
So, I mean, with regard to defamation, so at the moment, we have a lacuna in our criminal legal system. We have a lacuna. So what is the reason? So I would like to draw your attention, or I think there are law students, they are listening this program. So this is the penal code, our penal code was enacted in 1883 by the British rulers. 1883, for a period of 114 years, chapter 19 of the penal code carried the concept of criminal defamation. Mm-hmm. However, in year 2002, that particular chapter was removed from our legal system. Actually, parliament repeal this particular chapter. So accordingly, according to criminal legal concept of the country, so we cannot take any action in respect of defamation, individual defamation. However, the remedies are in the delict legal system. I mean the civil law. That particular individual, if a person has been defamed, so that particular individual should file a case in district court, and if he is able to win the case, so he can gain compensation. But according to the criminal law of the country, 19 years ago, it was repealed. The concept has been repealed by the parliament.
Right. So defamation, I think, as you clearly mentioned, has a bit of evolution process to go in terms of how.
But at the moment, we are in the process of, enacting a special law or with compatibility of the constitutional provisions. Now, especially this character assassination is a habit in Sri Lanka now.
Exactly.
Now, the fathers, they are crying, mothers crying, because sometimes, let's say, daughter's wedding is tomorrow. But today, certain photographs, video clips, they are published in Facebook. Then the groom, he doesn't attend the wedding, and the other parties, they are in panicky situation. So various social problems are created. So therefore, as you all know, in 2002, this particular chapter was removed after a famous case Chandrika Bandaranaike Kumarathunga, former president. She had filed a defamation case against one of the editors of leading newspaper. So after that, that particular editor was convicted for the offense, and so that was the issue. So after that, the chapter was repealed. But my personal view is that, not to punish the media institutions or the editors or the media directors, but to punish the individual, we need the same provisions.
Right. I think we covered quite a bit, and I think that shed some light on some things that a lot of people might not know when it comes to defamation. We're going to talk a bit about the other aspect now within our last segment, the public accountability. What responsibilities does the people have in all of this? Stay with us. This is Law, Land and Liberty.
Hi, my name is Nikini Shakya and I'm a law student. My question is about public accountability. What are the responsibilities of the public in the spread of correct information?
Welcome back to Law, Land and Liberty. We are in our last segment. We are in conversation with Senior DIG Ajit Rohan. Sir, within our last segment, I want to take the conversation a bit away to a more moral sort of standpoint, the public accountability. Now, I interrupted you when you said why these laws are in play. And I want you to touch on something that was in the media, which was criticized in the media, was this new legislation. I believe the Minister of Justice also quoted the Protection from Online Falsehood and Manipulation Act that was being enacted in Singapore, and taking in examples of how we should be more strict about this. So what responsibilities do you think fall on the media, on the people, or in correcting whatever information is there, in making sure that the right information is spread? How do you respond to that?
Well, if we take the examples of foreign countries, so the media freedom or the freedom of expression is not an absolute right. So everywhere elsewhere, there are restrictions. Because if a person needs to assassinate a character, in seconds he can do it. So the people are making comments, the people, they don't know whether these particular facts are correct or incorrect. So they believe that particular news, then thereafter, the character is automatically assassinated. Especially young children, girls, professionals. So their characters are assassinated. Therefore, everyone has a responsibility and liability. Now, you mentioned about the Singapore legislation. The Singapore statute is one of the strongest legislations in the world. And so you cannot use your Facebook account or your social media account, Instagram or whatever, in the way that you are thinking. So you should not create any panic. Now, for instance, the second wave started on the 4th of October. What happened? We didn't have any idea to impose quarantine curfew across the country, but there was a fake news circulated with Dherana logo. Dherana logo, and I think with Dilka Samanmali's picture. The government has decided to impose quarantine curfew across the country. The curfew would commence at 5 o'clock in the evening. That particular post was circulated at 3:30. So the everyone, they left the office, and the supermarkets were full with the general public, and petrol sheds, filling centers, pharmacies, everywhere elsewhere, it created a panic. Then, so what I need to emphasize is every citizen, every social media or the
users,
account holders, so they have a liability and responsibility. So some people, they create post, they create the news, but on the other hand, the others, they receive the news and then thereafter they forward, they share. So the both parties, they commit offenses. So being the police, we don't have any idea to harass the general public. And we don't need to harass the persons in vain. But the legislation, the parliament has empowered us to preserve peace in this country, to eliminate the fear of crime, to uphold the rights of the individuals of this country. So therefore, we have a duty and we have a liability. Therefore, we need to conduct investigations. So my humble request is,
So within your conclusive message, we have about 1 minute left.
Yeah.
You can tell us, if someone forwarding a message, that person has the same accountability of the one creating it, is it?
Yes. If that particular news creates racial disharmony, ethnic problems, religious disharmony, or it is against the national security, and it is against the morality, it is against the health rights of the country, it is against the other rights of the country, yes, he is liable. So he abates or he supports to commit that crime. Mm-hmm. So he is liable, and we are filing charges against him.
All right. I believe we touched on a lot of important topics and we really cleared a lot of doubts. I thank you, sir, for the time you have spent with us. I'm sure this is a very busy time period for you. Senior DIG Ajit Rohana, we wish you all the very best in all your endeavors and the work that you're doing for the country, which is very much recognized. That has been our take on Law, Land and Liberty, on understanding what can happen within social media, the legal take of defamation, the legal takes of misinformation, and we really laid down the facts and figures when it comes to how and what the law in the country dictates. So join us again next week when we come back with another contemporary topic that is pertaining to the law within the country. This has been Law, Land and Liberty. I'm Danit Thanwasam. Have a great night.